My name is Mike Taylor, and I came to the West Gate for a Masonic convention, walking around the floor, started talking to Michael about different things in Masonic lodges and stuff, and then we continued on, and he gave me the highlight of my life of coming in and helping him film the documentary with Lisa Marie and Priscilla Presley and Wink Martindale, and just made my whole trip to Vegas more than worthwhile. An experience that I'll never forget in my life and pass it on to my children and grandchildren.
Your Elvis story is what?
Well, my Elvis story begins with a night in July 1954 when Sam Phillips walked into WHBQ radio with an acetate, handed it to Dewey Phillips to play on his Red Hot and Blue radio show, who was on the air from 9 to midnight with 60% of the audience in Memphis playing black music for white kids. He put That's All Right Mama on the turntable. The switchboard lit up. I'm the only living person who was in the studio that night who was there to witness that. Sam had Gladys and Vernon's telephone number. I got on the phone, called her. She said Elvis was watching a double feature at the Suzor's on Decatur Street, a double feature Western, because he was so nervous, he knew his record was going to be played, he couldn't stay home and listen to the radio. They went down to the theater, walked up and down the aisle, found him, brought him down to WHBQ. Dewey put him on the air. I met him that night. And from that night to the day he died in 1977, he was my dear, dear friend.
What feeling did you get when you met him?
Well, you knew that night that something very special was happening.
You really felt that?
Absolutely. You knew that something very special was going on that night, but let's face it. At that time, on WHBQ Radio, which was the number one music station in Memphis, we were playing what I called vanilla music. Patti Page, Perry Como, Joe Stafford, that kind of music. But at night, 9 to midnight, Dewey Phillips was playing rock, what became rock and roll. He was playing, as I said, black music for the white kids. And that night when he put that record on, and later that evening when I met Elvis, he had such an aura about him that you knew he was really something extra special. But again, there was no way of us knowing. That night, we were experiencing music changing, and it would never be the same again. Never be the same again, and it never was.
Looking back then and just watching the whole thing blow up, what was that experience like for you?
Well, having grown up in Jackson, Tennessee, a little town.
It's different when you're at the root of something and you watch it blossom.
Yeah. Well, as I said, I had played vanilla music for all my career in radio, which was only 2 years up to that point. And then when Elvis happened and Rock Around the Clock happened from Blackboard Jungle, and Little Richard and the Everly Brothers from 1954, that night in 54 through 1959, that last 5 years of the decade of the 50s, you saw the experience of popular music totally change. It would never be the same again. And to be a part of that, I felt very special. I was part of Presley Mania. I was part of Beatlemania in the following decade. I was part of the decade of the 70s, the disco craze. So I feel very blessed to have been a part of so much of change in popular music. And this lady on my right dated Elvis for 6 years. We came together from two different directions.